Well, as we begin the new year, we are continuing the series, What Did Jesus Really Say? And I want to encourage you not to miss next Sunday morning. It's going to be the 32nd anniversary of the church. We're going to celebrate 32 wonderful years. And in both services, my father, who's our senior pastor, he's going to preach a special message casting the vision for the church in 2016. Then at the end of the service, he's going to pray and lay hands on all of us, anointing us for a successful and prosperous 2016. Amen? Amen. So if you want to forcefully advance, don't miss next Sunday. This morning, we're going to pick up and continue this series in Luke chapter 7. Luke 7, beginning in verse 36. And it says, "Then one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him." And over the past month or two, we've dealt with some passages that had Pharisees. And Pharisees were experts in the law. They were experts in the Torah. They were experts, sort of they saw or thought, in the commands, instructions of God. But as I've pointed out many times, in the time from the finishing, the completion of the Old Testament to the time of Jesus, in that time they had also come up with many of their own rules and regulations, thousands in fact. And they were more committed to their own rules and regulations, they were more committed to their interpretation of the law, of the Word of God, than they were to the Word itself. Have you ever tried to talk to another believer, they say they're a believer in Christ, about anything from the Word of God, and you can take them to a verse, you can show them what the Word of God says, but they're unwilling to actually acknowledge what the Word says because they believe more in their interpretation, more in their opinion of the Word, more in their own idea of the Word than they do in the Word itself. That's a frightening place to come to. And sometimes God has to intervene to get your attention. He did so in the life of Paul, who first was Saul, a persecutor of the church, a Pharisee. In fact, Saul had trained with one of the most famous Pharisees of their day, Gamaliel, and he was on his way to Damascus to persecute the Christians there when Jesus appeared to him and he fell off his horse. And so we have a Pharisee here, and he asked Jesus to eat with them. And you know, you in your life, you might get lunch or dinner invitations. They can be good or bad. Amen? Amen. Got to be careful with who you say yes to. Have you ever been to someone's house for dinner or gone out to dinner with someone and it turned into a criticism of you or your family or something you're doing or your children? So he asked him to come to his house. They sat down to eat. Verse 37, "And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner." So she had the reputation of being a sinner. You know, it's one thing if you have the reputation of working in real estate or being a doctor, being a lawyer, being a pastor. But if somebody says, "Oh, here comes Austin the sinner," that's not a good reputation to have for any reason. So we see that this woman came and she had a reputation for being a sinner. When she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, and she brought with her an alabaster flask of fragrant oil. We find out in Matthew and in Mark that the value of this oil that she brought, of this fragrance, was the equivalent of a year's wages. I mean, think of that. A year's wages. You study in the Gospels where Jesus talked about the widow's mite. They were there at the temple, and he was observing how people were giving on that day, and he used what he saw to educate the disciples on generosity. And he pointed out how there were wealthy people, and that out of their great wealth, they seemed to be putting in large amounts, but compared to their wealth, they weren't being generous. When a poor widow woman came, and she put in a small amount, but Jesus pointed out that for her, it was everything. Her giving was generous. And so notice, Jesus is at the house of a Pharisee, someone well off, well-to-do in their time, their society, and yet here comes this woman with the reputation of being a sinner, and she comes with a gift the equivalent of a year's wages. See, some people say, hey, you want to have lunch at McDonald's? It's 20 bucks or whatever. I don't know what it is. I guess if you each get a cheeseburger, that's $2. But there are other people, when led by God, and they may be looked down upon by others, they will give way beyond the level of people that act as if they're a big deal in the kingdom of God. And so she opened this flask of oil up, verse 38, and she stood at Jesus' feet behind him, weeping. Have you ever been in a service in worship and judged the person next to you? Maybe they began weeping. You judge them. Why are they weeping? Have you ever been in a service and somebody was just full of joy and happy and excited, rejoicing, maybe even dancing? Was there a judgmental or critical thought in your heart? What are they doing that for? Why are they so excited? Why are they so happy? Why are they rejoicing? Why are they dancing? It's an interesting thing to think about that when you step into the presence of God, and here she was in the presence of Jesus. When you are in his presence, will you have a reaction to it? You see, some people, when they are in the presence of God, they are overwhelmed by great joy, by great rejoicing. I mean, if right now we all saw a glimpse of heaven, you couldn't help but be joyful. Amen. Some people, when they're in the presence of God, they can't help but weep. I don't know how many times in my life and in times of prayer or in services, I have been moved to tears. There are some people, and they'll be in his presence, and they'll be led to dance in great joy and great gratitude because of what God has done in their lives. But how often, when people are moved by the presence of God, by being in his presence, are they judged for it? Are they criticized for it? Are they looked down upon for being moved by his presence? We'll find out at the end of this passage that this woman had come to faith. Jesus refers to her faith. See, if we can spend time in the Word, and we can spend time in prayer, or we can come to church and worship and never be moved, we have to ask ourselves whether or not we're spiritually alive. You see, here Jesus was in the house of a Pharisee. The woman is moved, but the Pharisee is not moved. She is moved to tears. She is moved to action. She is moved to obey. She is moved to give. The Pharisee is not moved at all. See, are you in a place spiritually in your life where his presence moves you? Moves you to joy. Moves you to tears. Moves you to greater obedience in 2016. Moves you to greater generosity in 2016? Or can you come to a prayer service? Or can you come to church? Can you come to a time of worship and not be moved at all? You see, if he stepped into this room physically right now, how would you be moved? Would you be moved at all? And it's a sobering thought to think about how he, in his stead, since he's at the right hand of the Father, he has sent the Holy Spirit to be with us. Yet how aware of the presence of the Holy Spirit are we? Are we moved? See, she was in the presence of Jesus. She had come to Jesus, and so she was moved. She was moved to action. She wept. And it says she began to wash his feet with her tears. Can imagine what Simon the Pharisee was thinking. And as I said, we have to watch ourselves in this. You're in church, all dignified. Somebody begins to break down and weep. You don't know why they're weeping. Amen. Somebody begins to dance and rejoice. Why are they doing that? You don't know why they're doing that. You don't know what's going on in their life and their circumstances. You don't know what happened on Friday or Saturday. You don't know what they're believing for. You don't know what they've been forgiven of. She wiped them with the hair of her head And it says, and she kissed his feet, anointed them with the fragrant oil. Remember, worth a significant amount, about a year's wages. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited Jesus saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, you know, a lot of times we get into trouble by speaking out loud or speaking on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. Did you see sister so-and-so? Did you see brother so-and-so? I mean, it's bad enough when you think it to yourself. A lot of times we say it, now people put it on social media for all the world to see. Well, I don't know why I didn't get that new job. Well, maybe your future boss saw your Facebook page. And the Bible gets into this, that we'll be judged by our words. He knows our thoughts. He knows our hearts. And Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount even dealt with our thought life. A lot of times people have the idea that the new covenant, following Jesus, the standards have been lowered. The standards have not been lowered. The standards have been raised. Where do we even get our thought life in check as Christians? And so he thought to himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet. So notice the woman comes, giving, believing, weeping, and the Pharisee judges, he criticizes, he critiques, and he says, if this man, if Jesus were a prophet, if he were a prophet, he would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. Verse 40, and Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And as I pointed out when we dealt with the Samaritan woman, this is what we must always ask ourselves when we read the Word of God. What is God saying to me? What is the Word saying to me? What is Jesus saying to me? That's when you know that the Word of God is alive to you in your life. Once again, the Pharisees, they had spent, this man, other Pharisees, they spent their lives studying the Word. Yet it's amazing, there are people and they can study the Word, they know a lot about the Word, they write books about the Word, but they are not saved. They themselves do not believe. They themselves can be in the presence of God and yet never be moved by His presence. It's a sobering thought. So Jesus answered him. Once again, we see that Jesus knows someone's thoughts. I think this is a lot of times why we waste so much time getting into this thing where we're judging and critiquing and evaluating others, because it excuses us from dealing with the stuff we need to deal with in our own lives. But if we would see the reality of the Word that God knows exactly what's going on here and in here, we would get busier about focusing on and evaluating and dealing with and addressing and improving what is going on in our own hearts and in our own lives. He said, Simon, I have something to say to you. See, today, what does Jesus have to say to you? What does Jesus have to say to me? What does he have to say to each of us? So he said, teacher, say it. Verse 41, there was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii. This would have been worth the equivalent of about a year's and a half wages. The other 50, so about 2 months worth of wages, a man's wages. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And Jesus said to him, you have judged, you have rightly judged. Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? And here we come to it. See, remember, this woman came to Jesus, and despite her reputation, despite the reputation she had, she was moved. And she was moved to be in the presence of Jesus. She was moved to do something for Jesus. She was moved to give. She was moved to be a blessing. She was moved to be a blessing to him. She was moved to honor him, to respect him, to worship him and anoint him for who he was, the Son of God, Yeshua, Emmanuel, God with us. Yet what had this Pharisee done? And so Jesus addresses this. He says, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. In their day, they traveled either by walking or by riding an animal like a donkey. And so, of course, they would become very, very dusty. And by the end of the day, by the dinner hour, they would be very dirty, very dusty. And so, in terms of their hospitality, the least you would do is offer somebody a bowl of water so they could wash their hands and wash their feet. Simon had done none of those things. She washed my feet with her hair, with her tears, and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss. Our problem today in our society is we read everything sexually. In their society, in the Middle Eastern culture, this was a form of greeting. And if you do this in the wrong places, you can get in trouble. You know, you watch an old Italian mob movie, the Italian men, they might do a kiss on the cheek, nothing sexual, simply a customary greeting. You do that, you know, at the gas station, you see a good old boy with a cowboy hat and a pickup truck, you say hi and then go give him a kiss on the cheek, you will not be having your best 2016, I guarantee you. So this would have been a customary greeting. So notice how even though this man, this Pharisee, he's well off in their time, their society, he probably had a nice home, he invites Jesus to dinner under the guise of doing something for him, yet does not even treat Jesus hospitably. Does not provide water to wash his feet. Does not even greet Jesus in the way you would in their society. He does not even greet Jesus as you would a stranger you are welcoming into your home. Cold, distant, spiritually dead. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she has loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same. That man, that woman, they love little. To her who has sinned much, she is forgiven, for she loved much. See, I think it's helpful in our lives to evaluate and to remind ourselves of how much God has done for us already and how much he has already forgiven us of. Have you forgotten what he forgave you of? Have you forgotten what he brought you out of? Have you forgotten what he delivered you of? Have you forgotten the sins that were in your life that have been washed away by the blood he shed on the cross? You see, it's easy to act high and mighty when not everybody knows your past, when not everybody knows your thoughts, when not everybody knows the inner depths of your heart, but God does. And if we'd be honest, we'd all admit we have much to be forgiven of. Some of us more than others. And Jesus points out the reality that when people have much to be forgiven of, they are more grateful, they are more appreciative, they demonstrate their thanks and their gratitude and their appreciation more. Have you ever met a believer that they literally act like they got saved merely on a technicality? That they're perfect, they've never sinned, but to make sure they go to heaven, okay Jesus, I confess you're my Lord and Savior. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I'm perfect, but I just want to make sure I get in. Have you ever met somebody that acts that way? But I would challenge you that people only get away with that because what they have done and what they are doing isn't known to everyone. Their thoughts, their heart, their actions. And we ought to, when we come to the Word of God and actually read what it says, we ought to all of us live sober-minded, as Paul said. Because there is a day coming when everything that is in darkness will be brought into the light. Better to be sober about the fact that we have all, as Paul says, sinned against God. We are all in need of a forgiveness. We are all in need of a Savior. And He saved us, He brought us out, and so we ought to be gracious and loving towards one another and how we treat people and walk in love. Walk in love. To whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. He said to her, your sins are forgiven. And those who sat at the table with them began to say to themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Then he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Notice here that Jesus speaks the same way he does in many of the healing stories in the Gospels. If you would study the healing stories in the Gospels, you would be surprised by what you would learn. A lot of times people have this idea that whether or not healing occurs, it has to do with the will of God, when it is His will that we each be saved and healed and delivered and set free. And so if you would read the Gospels for yourself, you would see that many times Jesus said to people, your faith has made you well. Your faith has healed you. Here He says, your faith has saved you. Now, how do we know that this woman and not Simon had faith? Her actions. What she did. How do we know that she had faith? We know she had faith because even though she had had a bad reputation, she came to Jesus just to be near Him. She came to Jesus to be a blessing. She came to Jesus to honor Him, to respect Him, to anoint Him for who He was, the Son of God, her Savior, Israel's Savior, our Savior. She came to Jesus and she was a blessing. She gave. See, how do we know somebody has faith? By the fact that they are moved in obedience to God. And so He says, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. About a month ago, on a Wednesday night, I believe, Pastor recommended David Oyedepo's book on prayer, Winning Prayer. I believe we have some copies in the cafe. And over the past month, we periodically addressed this thing of walking in love and walking in love to a greater degree in our relationship with God and walking in love in a greater degree in our relationship with others. And Oyedepo, in his book on prayer, highlights the importance of how love and walking in love is a critical determining factor in our level of blessing and the degree to which our prayers are answered. See, this woman on this day, she received something from the hand of God. Why? She loved much. She moved Jesus. Yet on this day, even though this man, this Pharisee, had Jesus himself come to his house, what did he receive? What was he left with? Nothing. Turn in your Bibles to 1 John. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John 5, beginning in verse 1, says, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. And once again, as I pointed out, how can you believe and not be moved in some way? How can you really believe and not be moved in some way? To dance, to rejoice, to weep in His presence, to a greater degree of obedience, to give, to love. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves Him, who begot, also loves Him who is begotten of Him, Jesus, the Son of God. By this we know that we love the children of God. So here John ties love of God and love for others together. How do we know somebody really walks in love? How do we know somebody really loves their brothers and sisters in Christ? How do we know somebody does not conduct themselves like Simon the Pharisee? By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep His commandments. So can I say that I'm walking in love when I'm not loving God? Can I say that I'm walking in love when I'm not keeping the commands of God? We live in a time and a place where a lot of people are looking for every reason they can come up with to not do the commands of God. There are even entire websites dedicated to not obeying the commands of God. You know you are in a very dangerous place spiritually when in your mind and in your heart you say, well, I know the Word says this, but I don't want to obey what the Word of God says, so I need reasons as to why that doesn't apply to me or I don't need to obey it. Or then you go around and you find 15 or 20 other people that they don't obey that. And then you feel better about it together with them. Verse 3, for this is the love of God. See, what does it mean to love God? Once again, how do we know that that woman had faith? By what she did. How do we know Simon did not have faith in Jesus? By what he did not do. He did not greet Jesus as you even would a stranger in their time. He did not provide water for him to wash his feet. Simon, a Pharisee, a wealthy man, he didn't even have a servant wash Jesus' feet. And once again, Pharisees consumed by studying the Word, he had the living Word right in front of him, not moved at all. This is love for God, as the NIV says, to obey His commands. The New King James, for this is the love of God, that we keep His commands. Now, you mentioned the word command. You mentioned the word obedience, and everybody begins thinking, oh, this is hard. This is difficult. This is impossible. But notice what the Word of God says itself. His commands, the commands of Jesus, His commands are not what? Burdensome. Yet how many of God's people every day, every week, every month talk about the commands of God as if they are a burden? Well, He saved me, but He's been a yoke around my neck ever since. See, people, we go around, we talk bad about our Heavenly Father. Well, I'm a Christian, but I have to do this, this, and this. I can't murder people. I can't hijack people. I can't sleep with whoever I want to sleep with. Sucks. And people behave that way. They don't talk that frank, but that's the gist of it. And then they wonder why they're not the light of the world, the city upon a hill, the salt of the earth. They wonder why people around them are not drawn to Christ. They're pushing men and women away from Christ instead of drawing people to Christ. If you'll have eyes to see it, the commands of God are not burdensome. They're for your benefit. He's trying to bless you. He's trying to protect you. He's trying to ensure that you have days as of days of heaven upon the earth. See, as a parent, why do you tell your toddler, your three-year-old, your five-year-old, don't touch the stove? It's because you don't want them to burn their hand on the stove. Why do we tell our young people it's important that they apply themselves and they study and they finish their educations and they pick a field of work that they can actually make money in? Why do we tell our young people that? Because we love them. Why do we tell our young people that it's better to wait for marriage? It's better to do it God's way. Why? Because it'll make things in life easier for you. The commands of God are not burdensome. But if you see them as burdensome, you have a heart issue between you and God that needs to be dealt with. You have a heart issue between you and His Word that needs to be dealt with. His commands are for your blessing. His commands are for your benefit. This is love for God, to obey His commands, and His commands are not burdensome. For whatever is born of God, that's you, that's me, whoever is born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. But once again, how do we know whether or not we really believe? Whether or not we really have faith? By what we do. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Now go back to chapter 3. Chapter 3, let's begin in verse 16. 1 John 3:16. By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us. You ever wonder how all this talk of, do I need to obey the commands of God? Does that command apply to me? Does that command not apply to me? Do you ever wonder how much it must grieve the heart of God? He loved us so much that he sent his son to die on the cross that we would be forgiven of our sins. And he raised him from the dead that we might walk in relationship with him, not as the servants or slaves of God, but as the sons or daughters of God. And yet when we lie and say his commands are burdensome, how it must grieve the heart of God as our heavenly Father. By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us. And we also ought to lay down our lives for who? The brethren, our brothers and sisters in Christ. See, maybe, what if, and I want you to think this over as we begin this new year, what if walking in a greater degree of his favor and his blessing and his provision has to do with how much we walk in love? How much we demonstrate our love, not just to God, but to our brothers and sisters in Christ. What if the thing hindering your prayer being answered, hindering the desire of your heart coming to pass, hindering you receiving all that you've been believing God for, has to do with the degree to which you have been walking in love, or you haven't been? And you have to evaluate yourself. You have to evaluate your own life. If you leave here today and get in the car, and with a child, with a spouse, with a family member, with a friend, you say, man, that message, it really must have hit home with you. Or have you, do you realize, right, that Austin was talking to you? That you did a very poor job of walking in love in 2015. If you do that, you've missed it. The point is, what does Jesus say to us? The point is to evaluate us and our loving and our giving and our forgiving of others. Walking in love. Verse 17, but whoever has this world's goods, that means whoever is blessed. Simon was blessed, and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him. Once again, the heart. How does the love of God abide in him? See, John here says something very similar to James, which I think is why people don't like James or John. Because James says, when he talks about faith, that faith without action is dead, James says if you see somebody hungry or naked and you do nothing about it, James says, what good is it? And people say, I believe in God. James says, even the demons believe in God. So if all you do is say, I believe in God, while you don't live the life and don't obey the commands of God, you have demon-level faith. And they're not saved. They're not a part of the kingdom of God. They're not the sons of God. Amen. Think about it. And so he says, whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart. See, here came a woman coming to Jesus for what? Salvation. Help, forgiveness. But Simon, as soon as he saw her, shut up his heart. When you see somebody who's new, when you see somebody who's coming for the first time, when you see somebody that's come out of a rough or difficult background, do you shut up your heart to them? Do you forget where God has brought you from? Do you forget what God has forgiven you of? Do you forget what Jesus has done for you? My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but how? In deed and in truth. See, that woman, she loved in deed and in truth. Yes, yes. She anointed him. She washed his feet. She wept. Her love could be seen. It was evident. It was tangible. Yes. It was the equivalent of a year's wages. Yes. See, everybody gets focused on the rich young ruler, where Jesus says to the rich young ruler to sell all he has. But Jesus commends a woman for giving a year's worth. A year's worth. She loved indeed in truth. By this, verse 9, we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. See, a hindrance to prayer, a hindrance to walking in the fullness of everything that God has for you is your heart condemning you. And there's two sides to this. On the one hand, if you're not obeying the commands of God when you know you should be, your heart will condemn you. If there are things in your life that the Holy Spirit has convicted you about, that you have not dealt with, that you have not addressed, that you have not fully surrendered to God, your heart will condemn you. But often, that's the only side of that we think about. But there's a whole other side to that, and that is this. If you do not walk in love, your heart will condemn you. And your heart will condemn you when you pray, when you attempt to enter his throne room to present your petitions, your prayers, your requests before him. See, what if there's more to this thing of walking in love than we realize? How did you greet your husband or wife when you woke up this morning? How did you treat the people you've come across on your way to church today? Your family members, the people at the door, the people in the atrium. After you leave church today, after you give your tithe, after you give your offering, how will you treat the waiter or waitress at lunch? Are you one of these Christians that'll leave a witnessing tract and no tip? What if walking in love has more to do with our level than we realize? It's time to evaluate for the new year. Verse 21, beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have what? Confidence toward God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him because of why? Because we believe. Because you attend church once a month. We have whatever we ask, why? Because we keep his commandments. So when a Christian does not have whatever they ask of him, what does that mean? They're not keeping the commands of God. And how did Jesus teach in the Sermon on the Mount that all the commands of God could be summed up? To love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and what else? To love your neighbor as yourself. See, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence toward God. And whatever we ask, we receive because we keep his commandments. And, everybody say and. You know, when the Bible says and, if, or but, all those words are important. It's sobering just even in the New Testament to look at how many times the New Testament says if. It's sobering. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. So, does being a jerk in the drive-thru please the Lord? Does treating your children horribly please the Lord? Does ruining your wife or husband's day please the Lord? Does being the person at work that everybody avoids please the Lord? Does being like Simon the Pharisee please the Lord? Does looking down upon people coming to Jesus moved by the fact that they are in need of great forgiveness and judging them or criticizing them, does that please the Lord? See, how often do our hearts and our thoughts and our minds betray us and hinder our prayers and hinder our blessing because we are not walking in love the way we should? We are not pleasing the Lord. We have whatever we ask because we obey his commands and we do the things that are pleasing in his sight. Verse 23, and this is his commandment, that we believe on the name of his son, Jesus. See, a lot of people, they're okay with that. They've got that. I believe. But he goes on. That we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and what? And love one another as he gave us commandment. Uh-oh. See, you can recite the Nicene and the Apostles' Creed, the Chalcedon Creed. You're like, what is he talking about? Just get on Wikipedia after the service. You can say that at First Baptist, First Presbyterian, whatever, there's a pew that was donated by your great-grandmother. You can tick off whatever you want to tick off, say whatever you want to say, check whatever box you want. It's not just believing. It is also doing. And whether or not you do demonstrates whether or not you really believe. And a lot of times, we, like the Pharisees, we get into doing all sorts of things to make ourselves feel good about our relationship with God when we're not doing the things that matter most to God. One of them being walking in love. I mean, because if you tithe and treat your wife like garbage, the Lord is not pleased with you. The windows of heaven will not be open upon your life the way they should.
Preach it, Pastor.
The Lord sees. He sees. When you lie down on your bed at night, you put your head on your pillow, He knows your every thought.
Amen.
When you go to work tomorrow, He knows your every thought while you're at work.
Amen.
When you're in traffic, you roll down the window and unbuckle your seatbelt and get your concealed carry, He knows, He sees all. He sees all. See, this woman, despite her past, despite her background, she came to the feet of Jesus not caring what anybody thought of her. And she wept, and she worshiped, and she honored, she respected, and she gave. She loved much. And how do we know she loved? By what she did. By how she treated Jesus, by how she treated the Son of God. And somebody might say, I treat Jesus great. Pastor mentioned this Wednesday, I'd remind you of it. We got to be careful how we treat people, because the Bible says that sometimes we entertain angels unaware. Maybe you should leave today thinking about whether you've cussed out an angel, flicked off an angel. Walk in love. And Jesus in the Gospels taught something very sobering. See, you go back to Luke. Look, let's end looking at what He said about her. Verse 47, Luke 7, therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are what? Forgiven. For why? She loved much. To whom little is forgiven, though, the same, that person they love little. But Jesus elsewhere taught that if we want to be forgiven, we must what? Forgive others. We must treat people the way we want to be treated. She loved, she gave, and she was forgiven. Pastor mentioned at 9 a.m., sometimes in our lives, Satan, he's busy reminding us of the things that we did in the past, but you have to remind him of the fact that he is defeated, his day of judgment is coming, and that we are forgiven, that we are washed in the blood of the Lamb, and that God has separated our sins from us as far as the east is from the west, that He remembers them no more.
Amen.
We're forgiven.
Yes.
Your faith has saved you. Go in what? Peace. And if you really want to have peace in 2016, you'll walk in love, because it's the people that don't walk in love that have no peace. I want to challenge you, as we head into this new year, to emphasize, to focus on in your life, walking in love. And walking in love towards God, towards our Heavenly Father in a new degree, walking in love towards His Word in a new degree, walking in love towards His commands to a new degree, because they're not burdensome. But not just that. Remember how He ended in 1 John 3? Not just believing, but also what? Loving who? One another. I want to challenge you to focus on walking in greater love towards the people around you. Forgiving, showing grace, showing mercy, remembering what God has forgiven you of. And I believe that if we will all do that in our lives, We'll experience the favor of God and the blessing of God and the provision of God and Him bringing our desires to pass to a greater degree than we ever have before. Because according to John, we'll be walking in a way that is pleasing to Him, pleasing in His sight. And then when we go to Him, when we worship Him in church, when we come to church, when we pray, our hearts will not condemn us. If you would, bow your heads and close your eyes. You might be here today and you would say, Austin, I have never come to Jesus. I have never come to Him like this precious woman. But I want to come to Jesus today. I want to be forgiven of my sins today. I want to have a new start, a new beginning with God. God loves you. And God loves you so much that He sent His Son Jesus. And He was born of a woman. That's what Christmas is all about. And He, despite every temptation, He lived a sinless life. And then even though He had done no wrong, He experienced a horrible death on our behalf. God took all of our sins and put our sins upon Him. He paid the price for you and for me that we could be forgiven, that we could enter into relationship with God, that we could walk with God as it was intended from the very beginning. And God raised Him from the dead. He now lives. And if you'll give Him your life, if you'll come to Him, weeping or rejoicing, but in gratitude, if you'll come to Him, you will have new life in Him. And from this day forward, He will live in you. If you're here today and you say, Austin, I've never done that. I've never prayed a prayer. I've never walked an aisle. But I know with all my heart that today I want to give my life to Jesus, that today I want to declare that from this day forward, I will follow Jesus. If that's you today, please raise your hand. Thank you, thank you. Heads are bowed, thank you. Eyes are closed. This is between you, me, and God. You might also be here today, and perhaps at one point in your life, you walked an aisle, you prayed a prayer. But somehow, through the course of life, you have come to a place like Simon. Your heart is hard. You say you believe, but you don't really obey the commands of God. You say you believe, but your heart is hard. And that's often reflected in the fact that you don't walk in love towards others the way you should, that you treat others horribly. You treat your brothers and sisters in Christ horribly. And all the while you put on a perfect front, acting as if everything is okay, when in your thoughts and in your heart, you're tormented because you know that everything is not okay. The Bible, though, encourages us and tells us that the mercies of God are new every morning. And we, like that woman, we can find forgiveness, but we must come to Him. His word says in 1 John 1 and verse 9 that if we confess our sins, He's faithful, He's just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you're here today and you say, Austin, I need to recommit my life. I need to make things right today. I've drifted. I've gone off into not walking in love. I've gone off into hardness of heart. I've distanced myself from God, from Jesus, but I know I need to come back. I need to make things right today. If that is you, please raise your hand. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to pray for the sake of those that raise their hands. As a show of support, I want to ask that we would all pray together. If you raised your hand, I'm going to pray, and I want you to follow along and pray these words after me. Say this. Say, Father God, I come to You and I give You my life. I believe with all my heart that Jesus lived for me, He died for me, and that You raised Him from the dead, and that from this day forward, He will now live in me. I repent of my sins and I ask You to set me free of anything that would hinder me in living for you. I give you my life. From this day forward, I will follow Jesus as the Lord and the Savior of my life. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. We want to help you get started in walking with God. And so after the service at Guest Services, if you'll go there, the wonderful people there have a book called God's Very Own Child. We want to give that to you to be a blessing to you. You can also ask an usher. They'll hand you a copy. We want to help you get started in living for the Lord. The Christian life is all about discipleship. David knew this even before Christ came when he said, those that are rooted and planted in the house of the Lord, they flourish. If you want to grow, if you want to mature, if you want to be strong, if you want to step into everything God has for you, you need to be rooted and planted here in the house of the Lord. Every week we're doing what we did today. We're simply opening the Word of God, laying out what the Word says, dealing with how we can apply it to our everyday lives. And if you'll do that, you'll discover His commands are not burdensome. And if you'll obey Him and love others, you'll end up in a very blessed place. We often tell people, you gave the devil some time, whether it was a year, 5 years, maybe longer. Give the Lord some time, and you'll be shocked at what God does in your life. Amen? Amen. Well, I hope the blessing was an encouragement and a blessing to you today.